Good evening, and welcome to all those not only here, but those watching us online. You know, I don't have any announcements tonight, but I thought I would share a little church humor. Young Jonathan was visiting a church for the first time. He checked all the announcements, posters, pictures along the walls. When he came to a group of pictures of men in uniform, he asked the usher, "Who are those men in the picture?" The usher replied, "Why, those are the boys who died in the service." Dumbfounded, the boy asked, "Was that the Sunday service or the Wednesday evening service?" Well, with that, I invite you to stand. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Most gracious God, as we gather in your presence, we pray that out of your glorious riches, you will strengthen us through the power of your Holy Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And may we, being rooted and grounded in love, be able to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled with all the fullness of God. May you be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Let's lift up our hearts and our voices in praise of our Lord.
Great is the Lord, he is holy and just, my soul will be just in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true, by his mercy he proves his love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory, great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice, now lift up your voice. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, draw our hearts to you, guide our minds, fill our imaginations, control our wills, so that we may be wholly yours. Use us as you will, always to your glory and the welfare of your people. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is written in the 17th chapter of Jeremiah. This is what the Lord says: "Cursed is the one who trusts in man, who draws strength from mere flesh, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. That person will be like a bush in the wastelands. They will not see the prosperity when it comes. They will dwell in the parched places of the desert, in a salt land where no one lives. But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. The heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, according to what their deeds deserve." The word of the Lord. The second reading is written in the first chapter of 1 Peter. "Since you call on a father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God, the word of the Lord.
Above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began, above all kingdoms. Above all wonders, above all that's ever known, above all wealth and treasures on the earth, there's no way to measure what's yours. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the cross and thought of me, Mama. And all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began, above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind the stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone like a rose, trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me, Papa.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 6th chapter. And this is similar to the sermon, the way the Sermon on the Mount begins, but this is called the Sermon on the Plain because it says that Jesus went down to a level place. Luke chapter 6. He went down with them and stood on a level place. A large crowd of his disciples was there, and a great number of people from all over Judea, from Jerusalem, and from coastal regions around Tyre and Sidon, who had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. Those troubled by impure spirits were cured, and the people all tried to touch him, because power was coming from him and healing them all. Looking at his disciples, Jesus said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. For that is how their ancestors treated the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, for you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when everyone speaks well of you, for that is how their ancestors treated the false prophets. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Well, Jesus kind of flipped things upside down, didn't he? Things that we oftentimes think as the blessings or the woes, and the things that we think of oftentimes as the woes, Jesus says are blessed. He switches the price tags. The things that are truly valued by the kingdom and really by God, the things that too often are valued in this world, are the opposite. The world values wealth, being well fed, the pursuit of happiness, and being admired for our smarts, or how, you know, however well we may be off in this world, being noticed. Even those who bash the rich are often rich themselves. And if we're honest with ourselves, we in America are truly among the rich of the world. We're in the top, 5%? Even many that we would consider poor in this country would be well off in many other countries. Jesus says, blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. He's referring to himself, those who are his followers. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. It's looking past just the worldly things and realizing, what are we really living for? The things of this life, or something beyond, something greater? We tend to value the here and now, the good things of life. And yes, those are good things. And those are, in many respects, blessings. And we should be thankful for all that God has provided us, home and family, daily work, all we need from day to day, good things. But Jesus points to heaven. See, what is the bottom line in your life? What are you living for? He didn't live for this worldly wealth. Jesus lived for heaven. And he was willing to go through and do whatever it took to bring us to heaven. Jesus taught, don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths do not destroy, and thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, what you treasure, what you value in life, that's where your heart will be. That's what you will be living for and going after. Don't live for what is temporary, but live for what is eternal. Heaven, life with God, God's kingdom. Heaven, eternal life. Is it worth living for? That's the question. In a way, it's kind of like deferred gratification, right? Are we living for something beyond just the immediate? Are we willing to sacrifice for the sake of the kingdom of God for something that is far greater, but you can't see it yet? Deferred gratification is resisting an impulse to take an immediately available reward in the hope of obtaining a more valued reward in the future. Self-control, but also I'd say spirit control. Living for God. As Christians we say that we are to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourself. That's the greatest commandment, and the second is like it, Jesus said, the second greatest commandment. Loving God and loving one another, loving our neighbor. I'd like to tell you a story. I don't know how many of you have heard of Charles Mutua Mully, but he was born in 1949, and he grew up in Kenya in a poor family. His father was a drunk. He would come home at times and beat his mother. And he really didn't have any work. And one day they left. He said he woke up. He was 6 years old. He woke up in the morning and everyone was gone from the hut. They lived out in the country. There was no sign of mother and father or his younger brothers. And so he wandered off. He found his uncle looking for what do I do? Where do I go? Looking to his uncle for help. And his uncle, he says, shoo him away. Get out of here. Wanted nothing to do with him. And so he went to the villages and he begged. He said, I became a beggar. And for 10 years, that's how I lived, begging. Just whatever I could get from anybody to stay alive. Interestingly enough, he was able to go to school. He did learn how to read, do arithmetic, and a few basic things in the public school. But he couldn't afford high school, which is what happens in countries like that. If you can't afford it, you just can't go on. So at 16 years old, he was ready to end his life. And a man invited him to church. And he says he was in that service, probably feeling a little out of place because that's not where he had grown up. But he heard the pastor say, you know, with God, nothing is impossible. Put your trust in God. God can do anything for you. God is there for you. And it struck him. And he started to believe. He says the next day, he decided to walk to Nairobi to find work. He was going to start to work. And so he did. He walked to Nairobi, which was 43 miles away, probably begging somewhat on his way. But he gets there and cannot find work. And he finally knocks on a door of a very nice-looking home. And the woman opened up. What do you want? Work. It was an Indian family. And the woman invited him in, fed him. And then he said he began to have a job there, working for the family. His duties included tilling the garden, washing clothes, cooking in the kitchen, and other domestic chores. A year later, Mully was promoted to a farm assistant and transferred to their farm, where he met his future wife, Esther. They married in 1970 and had 8 children. In 1970, Mully began working for a road construction company, oversaw the company's supplies and so forth, worked there for 2 years, and with the money he earned, he bought a vehicle, probably what we would think of as something the size of a minivan. And he began operating public transportation service, playing music in his minivan taxi, and people loved it. He also began engaging in agricultural business ventures. Mully founded with it, began to grow, and he called it Mully Ways, and And then he began to get into real estate and all kinds of things. He became wealthy. Hundreds of thousands of dollars in the bank. He began to be a chairman of boards on several international schools in Kenya from 1970 to 1991. Mully had become well-to-do. He says, I even traveled the world. He had gone to New York and different places, and he was going to a business meeting in Nairobi, and he parked his car, and some of the street kids came and said, we'll watch your car for you. And they kept after him, and he says, quit pestering me. Get away. And he went to his meeting. When he came back, his car was gone. It had been stolen, probably by the street kids that had promised to protect it. But he wouldn't give them a dime. So not having a car, he took public transportation home. And he said, there he sat on the bus, looking around at them, and realizing, this is me. This is where I came from. These street kids, these people on the bus. And it just struck him. It was an experience that he came up against, if you will, himself, wrestling with himself, what he had become. He said when he got home and he got in his other car and he just started driving. He was wrestling with God, with where he had come and what he had been. And he said, and I just drove and drove and drove till I was almost to Uganda. And then I stopped. And I sensed what God was saying. And he says, I just broke down and sobbed in tears until finally I said, yes, God. And he said at that point he was overwhelmed with a sense of joy. Like, now I know what to do with my life. That will be not just for this life, but really, where is your treasure? That's where your heart will be also. He went home, and his family would get together for dinner, and so they were all sharing and talking, and finally, he said later, as they were done with the supper, he says, well, I want you to know, I've decided I'm not going to work for money anymore. You can imagine what the family thought. They just looked at him. Obviously, the wife he had already talked. She was silent. But the kids were, what? What are you? And he sold everything, all of his interests. And he said, I'm going to live to take care of the poor. And he would just go out, and he would go out at night, and he would find street kids and bring them home and care for them. And they would feed them and give them a place to live. Well, the house became too small. And so he bought property. He built a home out in the country. And the reality was, as he found out, there was no well. And it was like, but God had told him, this is the place. And so he prayed all night. And in the morning he said, God told me where to dig a well. And they went out and they dug. And they dug. And he said, keep digging. Until finally they found water. And that was the place. His life changed. God truly became a part of it. In 1989, he had sold everything. He dedicated all his proceeds to helping street kids. He built a rescue shelter, medical care, education. It became the work of not only his life, but the life of his family. They became a part of this ministry. Molly's children's family has just under 3,000 children in their centers. Since 1989, when he began, Charles and Esther Mully have taken in more than 23,000 abandoned children. Imagine that. Yes, there's a movie, there's a documentary about his incredible life, Mully. I encourage you. You can Google it. It's on YouTube. He grew up poor, a street kid. Was blessed by faith in God and Christ. But his life became about wealth. He until he got a wake-up call. He entered into a living faith, a life of unconditional love and blessing. It blessed his family, but it blessed so many more. Blessings he never knew when his business had taken over his life and over his heart. As we heard in Jeremiah chapter 17, I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, according to what their deeds deserve. Or in 1 Peter chapter 1, since you call on a father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And Paul continues, now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for one another, love each other deeply from the heart, for you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living, enduring Word of God. This is how God has shown his love amongst us. Jesus laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our lives for one another. God is in the business of changing hearts. That is truly why Christ came. May he touch our heart as well. May we open our hearts to God. And it simply is, I think, bloom where you're planted. Love the people that God has put in your life. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, may we offer ourselves as living sacrifices to you, dedicated to being servants, to following you. Help us to be sincere in our love, joyful in our service, and patient in challenging times. Thank you for your example of service, your love for humanity. Heavenly Father, strengthen us through the power of your Holy Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And may we be rooted and grounded in your love. May our lives truly be a prayer of praise and a song of hope, so joyful that it may lead others into your kingdom. And all God's people say, amen. Invite the group to come back up. And just as Mully's heart was changed, God too can work on us and help us to become more and more like Christ himself. Let's stand and sing, Change My Heart, O God.
Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me. This is what I pray. Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. You are the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me. This is what I say. Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Search my heart, O God. May I be like you.
Let us affirm our faith together in the God that calls us through his Son, Jesus Christ, and enlightens our minds, empowers us for ministry, and keeps us in true faith through his Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us lift up our prayers of intercession. Let us pray in the Spirit of Christ. Lord God, you speak to us through the Holy Scriptures. Grant that we may hear, read, respect, learn, and make them our own in such a way that the enduring benefit and comfort of the Word will help us to grasp your ways of living and the blessed hope of everlasting life that we have through Jesus, our Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, you know our problems and our weaknesses better than we ourselves. In your love, by the power of your Holy Spirit, help us in our confusion, and in spite of our weakness, make us firm in faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up Christian churches everywhere and their leaders, that they will continue to proclaim the gospel of God's love in Jesus Christ to every corner of the earth, so that all may know the hope of your forgiveness and the precious gift of eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we bring before you those in need of your healing and comforting touch. We lift up Kevin Schultz, Lynn Brzezinski, Harry Kwasny, Connie Schiesel, Don Tiener, Lorraine Reindl, Dolores Johnson, Ginger Linsmeyer, Bob Klesick, Doug Wilson, Jim Lawrence, Ron Christensen, Elling Jones, Earl Graff, Wayne Allen Husky, and Char Minky. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up those having a birthday this week. Marcus Galian, Ginny Schwer, Larry Nadel, Eli Nelson, Cindy Peterson, Stephanie McCauley, Linda Mensa, Tyne Peterson, Sawyer Wenzel. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your bountiful mercy and love that we know we have through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And now let us pray together the prayer by which our Lord taught us to pray, our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he look upon you with his favor and give you his joy, his peace, and his love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In our closing hymn, Thy Word.
Thy word is It's a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Lead me near me to the end. My word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. My word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love, me and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. My word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. My word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Go in the Spirit of Christ to love and serve the Lord, sharing God's word, showing God's love, and serving God's world. Thank you for being with us this evening. Amen.